This is Covering the Spread. Here are your hosts, Jim Saunas and Dr. Ed Feng.
What is going on, everybody? Welcome on into Covering the Spread. That's right here on the FanDuel Podcast Network and numberfire.com, where today we are previewing the NFL Conference Championships with Jason McIntyre of FS1 and Fox Sports Radio, getting his thoughts on the Chiefs versus the Bills and the Packers versus the Bucks, letting you know where his mind is at for this weekend. My name is Jim Saunas. I am a senior writer and analyst for numberfire.com. Joined here, as always, by Dr. Ed Feng. You can find his work over at thepowerrank.com. And Ed, got a little stat for you here. We talk about establishing the run during the playoffs and how teams who can run the ball and play good defense are going to be the ones that go far. Can you name the top four teams in expected points, schedule-adjusted passing efficiency from this past year in the NFL?
The top four?
Can you name the top four teams in schedule-adjusted passing efficiency based on number fires metrics, I should say?
Sure. I mean, just I would assume these would be in many metrics, but I would say Bills, Chiefs, Packers, and I'm presuming it's Bucks. If this is the question you're asking me,
the top four teams in schedule-adjusted passing efficiency are the final four teams in the NFL this year. Go pay your Zeke Elliotts. Go pay your Todd Gurleys. But these are the teams that are playing this weekend. The top, the only running back here is Aaron Jones, and he's a free agent this year. So there you go. All of your work trying to show us how valuable passing offense is. All four defenses, also top 13 in rush defense. The Bucs are the only team in the top, I think, 20 against the rush. So this is an analytic person's dream, Ed. Like, are you just on cloud nine right now?
Yeah, no, I think it's fantastic, but someone's going to be like, wow, this is only something that's happened recently. But the truth is that this trend is like 30 years old, and you can just go back and look at yards per pass attempt where you account for sacks, and which you can have numbers for forever on profootballreference.com, and you can just show just how important the pass offense is. There are extreme outliers. You have to get Eli Manning lucky to get this far without a good pass offense.
People always say Trent Dilfer, but they don't realize that was a different era. Like, the 2012, 2011 or so, somewhere in there, there was a new era of football that started, and if you are not throwing the ball efficiently, you're not going to win anything. And I think that has been proven out this year. If you want the full rankings that I was citing, Brandon Gadula, my coworker over at NumberFire, did tweet those out today. So check that out, at Gadula13 on Twitter. Top four passing offenses in football. And I think, Ed, it's not just a vindication for analytics people such as yourself, but also it's fun football to watch good passing offense. That's where we're going to get across the board this weekend.
Yeah, absolutely. I've even forgiven myself for being down on Josh Allen at the beginning of the year. Like, I like watching the man throw the ball. I find it to be an accurate, fun experience. And, you know, given the Buffalo ties in my circle, on my wife's side, her mom and good friend, it's a good thing that I'm on their side these days, hoping for these wins.
Well, even when Josh Allen was not this, he was always fun, because it was like there was the three true outcomes in baseball: a walk, a strikeout, or a home run. His was a sack, fumble, or a touchdown. That was what it was every single drop back. And it's still kind of that ratio, except the touchdown pie piece of the pie just keeps getting bigger. Yeah. So Josh Allen, a fun player always, but a fun and good player now. It's going to lead to some really fun games this weekend. Looking forward to those for sure. We're going to break them down with Jason McIntyre. He is on Twitter at Jason R. McIntyre. You can find him on FS1 and Fox Sports Radio. He is the host of the Straight Fire podcast. He is also on Talk the Line with a bunch of really smart people over there as well. And Jason, if you are a longtime consumer of FanDuel multimedia content, an alum of More Ways to Win, which you find on TVG. He was on there back in the day with Lisa Kearney, with Dave Weaver. We're getting Jason back on the FanDuel airwaves for today to break down these games. Also, make sure you're subscribed to Covering the Spread wherever you get your podcasts. And while you're there, make sure you leave us a rating and review as well. We are back to once weekly podcasts. We will have two podcasts previewing the Super Bowl, one focusing on the game itself, one more prop heavy to try to get you set for those. And get you set for the Super Bowl. So we'll still have two podcasts the next 2 weeks getting you set for that game. So make sure you subscribe to Covering the Spread wherever you get your podcast. Before we bring Jason on for today, though, we do have to go back to last week. Tough week across the board from a betting perspective. We're going to go through what we got right, which was just Ed, what we got wrong, which is the rest of it, and get set for this upcoming weekend.
Covering the past.
So last week here on Covering the Spread, we had Kelly Stewart on to preview the divisional round. Make sure you follow Kelly on Twitter at Kelly in Vegas. Check her out on Bleacher Report and on Wager Talk. And like I said, tough week, more so for me than Kelly. And Ed, you had a good week for sure. Kelly wanted to tease the Packers and the Ravens. At the time that we spoke, that would have had the Packers minus a half point and the Ravens at plus 8.5. And the Packers side did hit. They won by 14 points. The Ravens, though, lost by 14, so they couldn't hold up their end of the bargain. Obviously, Lamar Jackson getting hurt didn't help that. A pick six did not help that either. Kelly also mentioned the over on that game at 50.5. Close to 50, but the wind there wound up being a bigger deal than it initially seemed it would be. So the under hit there were just 20 total points being scored. And Ed, I think based on Twitter sentiment, that Saturday night game, it seems like a lot of people had teased the Ravens because I think like Nick Costos was very upset with the Ravens.
Wait, hold on. Nick Costos was very upset. Is that our example for being?
It's never happened before, so this is a new thing
for being a rare event.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it made sense. They were at 2.5. You know, you get across 3, you get across 7. It made a lot of sense. Apparently, a lot of people went that way, and apparently, it did not go well. Right. And like, I hear you, Nick and others. It was a frustrating game if you had the Ravens plus 8.5 because, like, it could not have broken any worse between the pick. The pick six is one thing. But having the pick six and Lamar getting hurt, that is peak frustration.
Well, and not only that, but I mean, how many more yards do the Ravens have than the Bills in that game? So even above and beyond that, I mean, Justin Tucker missing those field goals, not being able to convert more when they were closer towards the end zone. Yeah, that's peak frustration.
So
I'm just giving you a hard time, Nick, by the way. I hope you're
justifiable venting, though, I will say. It was a rough Saturday night for sure. Sunday went better for you because you were in a good zone here because Kelly was on the Saints money line at minus 166, but you had the Bucs plus 3, and the Saints closed at minus 2.5. So you did get that number inside of 3. Hopefully you got it when Ed was talking. The Saints were up 20-13 in the third quarter. But the turnovers bit them really hard. The Bucs closed things out on a 17-0 run. So a good call for you on that one. And I feel like the process did align well for you there in getting the Bucs plus 3.
Yeah, and it's good when kind of the numbers agree with, I don't want to say my gut, but my feeling about that game in terms of the upside of Tampa Bay's offense, which I will continue to talk about ad nauseum probably until they lose. But also like just the little bit of a lack of confidence in New Orleans, despite how good they look in the numbers. Talked about Drew Brees and just the average depth of target last week. I don't know if that affected his game. I mean, he's not going to throw 3 picks in most NFL games, right? So a little bit lucky there. But, I mean, Tampa Bay did have more overall yards in that game, if I'm not mistaken. And I think they lived up to their end of the deal.
And it wasn't just the turnovers. They played well. Like, they played some good football there, for sure. And it was revealed today that Drew Brees apparently had a torn rotator cuff, which seems like it should be a violation of the injury report protocol. But, like, you know, not mad about that. Wouldn't want to have that information.
Yeah.
Well, why would you? I guess like if he's not limited in practice, like maybe that's the workaround. Like if he's doing the full complement of things in practice, like he played through it, obviously. But like it seems like something you should be forced to divulge if you're playing with literally a torn rotator cuff when you are an NFL starting quarterback.
So he had those like Justin Field type meds in him during that game.
Oh, yeah. He had the good stuff.
And maybe that, you know, obviously they brought in Jameis to throw that deep pass.
Right. Which they've done with Taysom Hill this year, too. It's been the same. They've done that as well.
Yeah.
But it was...
That's a very interesting piece of news, right? Because clearly no one knew about that beforehand. I mean, I think that market moved because that was the right way to go.
Right. You're saying the market didn't move because Taysom Hill was ruled out, you know? He's not moving lines out here?
Not in my world, but maybe...
Nope.
I don't know. I'm not the world's number one expert on why markets move. So
not in most worlds, Ed. So you're good to go there. I wanted the Browns over their team total 23.5. And this is why I have to defend all the people who were complaining about the Ravens on Twitter on Saturday. Because in my head, I was complaining this entire game on Sunday as well. There was late money on the Browns, which did push the Chiefs down to -8. The total came down a bit too. So the team total for the Browns stayed pretty stagnant here at 23.5. And they could have gotten over if they had scored late, which was possible, because they were moving the ball and decided to punt, but Kevin Stefanski abandoned his... I know we rag on him for running the ball too much, but he does have an analytics background with his emphasis on play action. He just does run the ball too much. But they could have gotten over if they had decided not to punt there, or if Rashard Higgins hadn't fumbled out of the end zone after being targeted. Like, if one of those things had happened, they would have gone over, because they scored 17 points. They didn't. It was frustrating. So I think the Ravens complainers are valid, because in my heart, I was feeling the exact same thing on Sunday. It was a very frustrating weekend across the board, except for you being on the Bucs +3.
Yeah, I mean, I think the Higgins play is interesting on so many levels. First of all, it was targeting and a very dangerous play. Second of all, the only thing I could see on Twitter was this is the dumb rule where the ball goes out and the touchback goes to the defense. And my thought is, I think the defense should get the ball every time it goes out of bounds. Right?
You're not alone in that, by the way. I think it's Ryan Nanny. He works for Banner Society. Yeah. He was always on a podcast back in the day with Spencer Hall. I think he's actually still on those podcasts, Spencer Hall. I think he's floated that possibility. I don't know. It might not be Ryan. I might be totally misquoting this. But you have people in your corner here.
Well, everyone's like, oh, it's all consistent, because if it just goes out a yard before, then the offense gets the ball at the half yard line and it's a different game. I was like, fine, let's give it to the defense. Let's penalize the offense for coughing up the ball. That's what I think should happen.
All I hear is that you hate points and you hate fun. Like, that's the vibe I'm getting here.
Yeah, me who had the over 75 in the college football championship. I hate points, for sure.
Ed hates points. Send all your gripes there. I'm still mad about it. But at least Baker played well. I can at least take solace in that. So Jared Goff we can talk about later, but at least Baker played well. I can have my one solace from that past weekend. So we're going to put the divisional round in the past and never think about it ever again. We're going to talk to Jason McIntyre about the conference championships here in just one second. But first, sports betting is great. Sports betting with FanDuel Sportsbook is even better. Right now, FanDuel Sportsbook is giving you a chance to bet on any sport with reduced risk with their exclusive same-game parlay insurance. Simply place a 3-leg or more parlay to be eligible for the offer and follow along as the game unfolds. If you don't win one of your bets, FanDuel will refund your bet at $25 in side credit. What do you have to lose? Head to FanDuel Sportsbook and place your same game parlay today. Must be 21 plus and present in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Illinois, West Virginia, Indiana, Colorado, Tennessee, or Iowa. Refund issued as a non-withdrawable site credit. Max refund $25. Terms apply. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. Or in Colorado, call 1-800-522-4700. In West Virginia, visit 100gambler.net. In Indiana, call 1-800-9-WITH-IT. In Tennessee, call the Tennessee Red Line, 1-800-889-9789. Let's bring on Jason McIntyre now to preview the conference championships. Once again, follow Jason on Twitter at Jason R. McIntyre. Check out his podcast, the Straight Fire Podcast, which goes up pretty regularly. You can also check him out on FS1 and Fox Sports Radio with Talk the Line. We're going to preview the conference championships with Jason right now.
Covering the present.
Let's bring Jason McIntyre into covering the spread to preview the NFL Conference Championships. Jason, I appreciate the time. How you doing today?
I'll be better this weekend, I hope. It was a tough divisional weekend for me, Jim. The turnover just went against me, whether it was Lamar's pick six or Drew Brees throwing three picks in his own end. You know, those didn't work out for me, but thanks a lot. You know, we've worked together before, and I've had Ed on my radio show. I know you guys well. You guys do great stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. We're glad to have you back in the FanDuel multimedia sphere, back in your TVG More Ways to Win days. Good to have you back in the airways for sure. And the conference champion or the divisional round was tough for me too, because I was on the Browns team total over 24. The Rashard Higgins fumble was tough for sure. But I think it's tough to like kind of scrub that from your memory when you have like those tough weekends like that. What specifically for you was kind of the bugaboo last weekend?
Well, I mean, I will say I got lucky with Browns Chiefs. I had the under, I had the Browns getting points, and then I had one of these silly teasers. Listen, teasers have been incredible this season. I don't know about you guys, but just teasing, I teased down the Packers and the Chiefs, the favorites. I mean, it was, not great juice, obviously, but it felt like an easy winner, and those have been performing well. I mean, the Bills this year, I think a ridiculous 16-1 or something like that on 6-point teasers. You got to find an edge wherever you can. That Lamar Jackson interception, I read a story, guys, where over the last like 20, 25 years of playoffs, that's one of the biggest game changers since that Super Bowl pick six, Harrison in the Super Bowl against the Cardinals. Like, that's how big it was for the Ravens. It was just brutal. And then Lamar gets hurt like 2 plays later. Just disappointing.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, the Bills really didn't perform like we expected them to. I mean, their pass offense has been so good. You look at the yardage in that game, but it's so hard to overcome a pick six like that, right? Like, you were on the doorstep.
I'll add this, I don't want to give away a pick later, but the Buffalo Bills have not played great in 2 playoff games, outgained in both of them. The home field advantage kind of mattered. I know they didn't have fans all season, but when they were against the Colts, if you read the quotes from the Indianapolis players, they were like, that stadium was loud. It's maybe it only had 7,000 people. But even when Justin Tucker, best kicker of all time or whatever, misses 2 kicks off the uprights, it was rocking in Buffalo, and they won't have that this weekend. I do believe that will be a hindrance to them.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and just going to Kansas City, where they've had fans since week one, at least, a couple throughout this time. So definitely used to that for sure. And tough place to play in general. So we'll see how that plays out this weekend. And Jason, before we get into the actual games, I do want to go through some more broad stuff with you. Some overview stuff from a betting perspective. Both these games are rematches. We do have at least one game of sample for both teams. The problem is, it's hard to know how much those matter, because that Chiefs-Bills game, a lot of different personnel. John Brown is not 100%. He played during that game, but not 100%. David Bakhtiari got hurt mid-game for the Packers against the Buccaneers. He will miss the entire game, but now they've had time to kind of game plan for that. So what lessons can we draw from looking at those initial games and trying to predict how things are going to play out this weekend, or do we just have to toss those out because they both happened so long ago?
Yeah, I would more toss out the Packers-Bucks game. If I remember, that was like the greatest spot ever for Tampa Bay. Well, not the greatest ever, but it was a great spot. They were coming off the Thursday night loss to the Bears, where they didn't have their full complement of players, and it was like they looked awful in an island game. Green Bay came in, I think, 4-0 against the spread and undefeated, and it was like, everybody and their mom was on the Packers on the road as a favorite, and Tampa was an easy layup there. Even though down 10-0, you were still like, okay, we'll see. And the one thing that scares me, I really like the Packers this weekend, but when you look at that game, and you can go on YouTube and like watch the condensed version, Green Bay did some struggles against the zone. Specifically, Aaron Rodgers was awful against the blitz. It was like an exotic blitz package that Bowles dialed up. He's a former Jets coach, so I'm like a fan of Todd Bowles. He would drop the defensive lineman back and have the linebackers blitz, and Rodgers did not recognize it well and really struggled. I have the numbers here. He was like 5 of 14 for 61 yards with 2 picks. And this is a guy who threw, I think, 5 interceptions all season. By the way, 4 of them have come against the blitz. I just wonder, though, the Packers receivers this time are at their full complement. Everybody's healthy. So bottom line, I don't pull too much away from that game. I actually think you could take something from Bills Chiefs. Buffalo had a good strategy in that game, right? The defense dropped into a zone. They kept everybody in front of them. No big plays to Tyreek Hill. There was a weather impact there, I think, in the rain. The problem was Josh Allen was awful. He had one of his worst games of the season. And they said, we'll give you Clyde Edwards-Helaire for $1.60. Go for it. And they were kind of in that game. They nearly covered. I actually think that defensive strategy will pretty much work again, especially, with Mahomes not having Edwards-Helaire. He may be back. I haven't seen the practice report today. But bottom line, I would take away more from Bills Chiefs.
Yeah, Edwards-Helaire did get in a limited practice on Wednesday. But, it's concerning that he's still limited and he's missed, I think it's 4 weeks now, yeah, with that hip and ankle injury. Like, he's not at full health. Even if he does play, he's not fully healthy yet. With the Todd Bowles point is interesting because, like, that's a staple of Todd Bowles' defenses is exotic pressures. And I think that as a Jets fan, you can definitely appreciate that, especially going from Todd Bowles to Adam Gase. Pretty tough transition there for sure. But now you get Robert Saleh. So, like, hey, you know, everything's okay, right?
Well, I'll say, listen, when Peyton Manning endorsed Adam Gase, bring him on. Like, sure. Peyton Manning knows a thing about football. Robert Saleh, it's tough to get me very excited about this. You guys know it's an offensive league. I mean, I'll just say this. At least we didn't hire Dan Campbell.
There's that.
I love the dig at that's a great dig. I mean, I think the Peyton Manning recommendation of Adam Gase is probably getting less and less weight after two stints now. Jason, we would love to know about how you evaluate units that have been playing much better of recently than before. So, you know, we're talking about like the Bills defense and in my mind the Bucs offense, first year of Tom Brady. Do you take that into consideration a lot, a little bit, not at all?
Yeah, I would say my issue with the Bills defense, I think it's a little bit overrated at this point. We watched the Colts. I think they had 8 or 9 possessions, and every single one got into Bills territory. They had like 450 yards of offense. Like this Bills defense, I know they held the Ravens to 3, but again, we talked about it earlier. The pick 6 was kind of a big deal. Justin Tucker misses 2 field goals. He's automatic. I'm not a huge believer in the Bills defense. As for the Tampa Bay defense first, you know, they let Taylor Heinicke, I think he's the 4th string guy in Washington, go up and down the field. You know, he had a pretty solid game. Obviously, they won and covered, but I guess they didn't cover the closing number. It was close. But Taylor Heinicke showed well. Drew Brees, of course, 3 picks. But to me, that was more about Brees than the Tampa defense. Like, they could see that he couldn't do anything. They didn't have to worry about the Taysom Hill factor, and they just sat on every route and were just dominating. As for the Tampa offense, you know, they were down in that game before the Jared Cook fumble. Like, they're trailing 20-13, Tampa really on their heels defensively, and then Jared Cook coughs it up, and, you know, that flipped the game there. So maybe I'm not bullish enough on the offenses, but neither of them, Tampa Bay or Buffalo, are really impressive to me at this point.
Yeah, and I think the Buffalo defensive number is interesting, especially with regards to the total for that game between the Bills and the Chiefs, because 53.5 kind of assumes good defense out of Buffalo, and if you are on board with Jason and assuming that Buffalo defense might not be as good as it's being billed, there could be some advantageous numbers there. Let's talk about some futures with you, Jason, while we have you here, before we talk about the games, because there's still a lot to be decided here. It's a pretty wide open market. Packers and Chiefs both plus 210 at FanDuel Sportsbook. Bills plus 330. Tampa Bay plus 430 as well. They're a little bit longer than the other ones. Are you seeing any advantageous numbers there in the futures market before we get to these conference championships that you'd want to pounce on now before they move?
It's interesting. I basically have laid out that I'm kind of leaning toward both favorites. And you're looking at the futures, and I'm like, well, you know, is there value in Buffalo if Pat Mahomes is not 100%? And I'm not just talking about the concussion. What about the toe? You know, if you look closely, in the second quarter, he was off on some throws. Romo pointed it out. Couldn't totally plant and didn't look 100%, although the Bills, they don't have much of a pass rush. So maybe you could make a case for the Bills. And then if you are a believer that Tom Brady can get this done and the cold weather is just a silly narrative out there, they go get to play a home game in the Super Bowl.
Yeah, and it's true.
That would be nice. Certainly, I'm sure, sleeping in your bed, home-cooked food. Although I don't know if that will hold up. You know, maybe they bubble up the teams given COVID. I haven't seen any clarity on that, but I would guess the Bills. I'm curious what you guys' models say. I don't have one myself, but I would say the Bills probably carry the best value of any of those four.
Well, I've been building out like models throughout the year, trying to, you know, generate my own numbers, because it's been a weak point of mine is trying to have my own numbers I can lean on as opposed to looking elsewhere. And my numbers like the Bills a lot versus the spread. They actually think that's basically a pick 'em between them and the Chiefs. So I think that if you were to buy into those, I personally can't do that because I refuse my like one creed as a betterist, never root against Patrick Mahomes because that would scare the poo out of me. And I don't want to do that for my own mental sanity. I don't want to root against Pat Mahomes. But like if we're talking from a numbers perspective, I would think my numbers would actually view that as being a pretty advantageous number plus 330 for Buffalo. So yeah, I think that's the way you're thinking about that is correct, at least in my eyes. I don't know about what Ed's numbers might say, but at least from my perspective, it makes sense based on the numbers.
Yeah, I mean, I'm definitely on Tampa Bay. I would be on Tampa Bay's futures because I think my numbers like them. They're pretty good, and I don't think they fully capture what that offense is capable of. Brady's been great this year. His PFF passing grade's been excellent. His receivers have been hurt, but Mike Evans and Chris Godwin and who knows what Antonio Brown can do. And some of those young guys really kind of showed up last week too. So I don't necessarily think my numbers capture the full upside of what they're doing. So, and that'll probably be apparent when I talk about the games a little bit later as well. Jason, let's move on to some of the games. We got Tampa Bay at Green Bay. Packers opened. It was at 3.5 until yesterday, and then it kind of came down to 3 in a lot of places. Total of 51.5 right now at FanDuel Sportsbook. Do you think that movement towards Tampa Bay is justified, or are you're going with the favorite?
I would not like Green Bay at 3.5, but I am curious. Like, if you guys remember Sunday, there was kind of a late move on Tampa. I think it crossed through 3 to 2.5. Mm-hmm. I was like, this is not good. late move, pretty clear, right through 3.5, through the key number of 3, down to 2.5. You know, but I'll still stand by it, guys. I go back to that, you know, Tampa Saints game. Again, I would bet on the Saints again. Is Drew Brees going to have 3 picks in his own end? Right. One was nearly a pick 6, and then the fumble. You know, you lose the turnover margin 4-0. You're not going to win in any games. It's difficult for me to build a case here for Tampa. I do like hearing everybody say, well, it's the cold weather. And, you know, it spent me looking through the Tampa schedule this year, and the Washington playoff game was like 35 degrees. And I watched the video, and like no skill position players on Tampa were wearing long sleeves. And you know how they have like the handlers on the sideline with the parkas to put over everybody's shoulder when they come out of the game? None of that in Washington. None of that in the Chicago game from earlier this year. So, I kind of scoff at this whole cold weather narrative. It's fun to talk about, well, Tom Brady played in New England. It doesn't matter. But what about the rest of the team? You know, they haven't played a cold weather game all year. I don't really buy into that. I just look at, in the earlier meeting, I talked about Tampa with the zone and the exotic blitzes from Bowles. I don't know how he levels up from what he did, a masterful game plan in that one. Rodgers is going to be ready for that. They know what's coming. Adams is at the height of his powers. Lazard is healthy. MVS is healthy. I mean, Robert Tonyan was not a huge deal in September. He has become like one of the better tight ends in the league. One of Tom Brady's favorite guys. The emergence of Dylan, the running back, I don't know his health status, but he looked good down the stretch. Like, I just think Green Bay is, outside of the Bakhtiari injury, as healthy as possible. And I'd like them at 3. If it goes back to 3.5, I guess you take a bite out of Tampa.
Yeah, the Robert Tonyan point is pertinent, I think, because like you said, his role had not fully formed by that time. If you look at expected points added per target for every tight end who got at least 35 targets this year, Tonyan was the best tight end in football based on expected points added per target when Rodgers was throwing the football. Like, he was actually an effective member of that offense. So they add Lazard because he was not there for week 6. They have Tonyan in a more fully formed role. They can plan around not having Bakhtiari, whereas last time it happened in game. I think those are all impactful factors that do help Green Bay in this one. So are you're going with Green Bay -3 for this one?
Yeah, you're trying to pin me down on a Wednesday, huh, Jim? I'm starting to look for props. I don't know if you guys have seen anything on MVS or Lazard, but I keep having flashbacks to Carlton Davis, the Bucs cornerback. You know, he had a good game last week against the Saints. Listen, it's one thing to hold down Michael Thomas, who apparently needs like major surgery given his injuries. Go back to that Kansas City Chiefs game, and Tyreek Hill absolutely lit up Carlton Davis. Like, he could not hang with him on any level. Lazard and MVS, they have some speed in the secondary. I think there could be a big play had by perhaps MVS. I will take a flyer on one of his props.
Okay, MVS is 31.5 for his receiving yard total.
Oh. That's basically like one reception. Right?
He's either gonna get
feast or
like, donutted, or right. He's gonna go over that on one catch. Like that's basically how things work with MVS. His total receptions number is 2.5. That seems about right based on the way it goes. Here you go, Jason. Longest reception for MVS is 16.5. That's the prop for him. So well, you could net a 20-yard catch in the first quarter and call that one good. So
I love
maybe we can,
don't you? Where you bet a player prop and it's just boom, done in the first quarter. You know, kick your feet back and enjoy the game. That would be nice. But have you guys dove into any props yet or no?
I mean, I usually get into. I'm more of a touchdown scorer person when it comes to props. Okay. I love the first touchdown prop bets just because I think that they're fascinating and it does overlap a lot with fantasy football, which is where my background lies. So I think those ones to me are the most fascinating. The running back situation in this game is very muddy with regards to, you mentioned A.J. Dillon, you know, the question marks around his health, but also Ronald Jones, Leonard Fournette. I have no idea what that distribution is going to look like. So I think the touchdown scorer ones to me are the ones that I find that I have the most fun with for sure. They've been.
You know, you mentioned Fournette. You know, I was going to save this. I do a Fox Sports column. But if you look at Fournette's carries this season, his two highest carry games were the playoff games. And I don't necessarily know how much of that has to do with the Jones injury. Or, you know, we know Fournette's a good closer. Some of his fourth quarter numbers in Jacksonville were extraordinary. He's a Derrick Henry. You don't want to have to tackle a 230-pound guy in the fourth quarter after 45, 50 minutes of football. And Fournette's been pretty good. You know, maybe it has to do with we don't want Tom Brady airing it out 45 times in a game. Let's hammer away with Fournette. Because if you look back at that earlier meeting, Tampa and the Saints, I think – you know, the second meeting, the 38-3 bloodbath, they had like three carries for Ronald Jones, I think, in the whole game. And they established the run as mocked and obviously funny. But they're going to need a ground game here. And I do believe Fournette could be in line for, you guys probably have the numbers in front of you. I'm curious as to if is he over 50 yards or no?
42.5 is his number.
Wow.
I mean, given the last 2 weeks, Ed, does that sound low?
It sounds a little low, but I don't really love how they've been able to run the ball. Like, I think their real strength isn't going to be throwing the ball to those top-notch receivers. And then also, you got to think of the game script, too, because Green Bay's been really good at getting out to leads. Yeah. So, you know, I still think Tampa Bay can win this game. I mean, they clearly have the engines. But I don't know if it's going to be a situation where they're up in the second half and really running the ball, giving Fournette those chances to get over that total.
I will say for you, Jason, that in that first game, it seems that the game plan for Tampa Bay was to run because their early down first half pass rate was 48%, I believe, in that game. That's a very low number. They were trying to run the football. So that does back up your point. Maybe
last week, I think Akers had a pretty solid game, right? They just, you know, unfortunately couldn't get stopped. Yeah. So the Packers scored 5 straight times,
Right.
Well, that's a good point, too. Like, Green Bay sometimes does not care to stop the run at all. So
they actively just don't care. Like, that is their mindset on defense. Okay, so we're checking out some MVS props, checking out some Leonard Fournette props, and liking the Packers in general here. What about the other game? We got the Bills and the Chiefs. Chiefs, 3-point favorites. Total here is 53.5. And before we started recording here, Jason, today, Patrick Mahomes got in a full practice for Sunday's game, which means that it seems as if there is a 107% chance Pat Mahomes will play on Sunday against Buffalo. So are you good to fire away now, or does that toe injury give you pause around how you want to dabble in betting this game?
Yeah, I mean, you know, is it a big show? Did they do a big show today to make sure Mahomes got out there just so the independent neurologist, which he still has to get cleared by, to kind of hopefully influence things so he plays? And, like, then it gets muddy, and then you're talking about, are they forcing him out there? Is he wanting to get out there? Well, he was running in the tunnel during the fourth quarter. He's fine. Listen, man, obviously player safety matters a ton. But the toe injury, there is something there. This is a guy who last year in the postseason was pretty dynamic running the football. He had 2 rushing touchdowns in the playoffs last year. He only had 2 all season this year. My guess would be coming off that injury and the toe, he ain't going to be doing much running against the Bills. But it's tough for me not to look at the Chiefs here. Did you say it's at 2.5?
It's at 2.5 some places. It's at 3 at FanDuel Sportsbook. It's 3 minus 115. So it sounds like FanDuel Sportsbook is very much shading towards not going to 2.5, but I have seen some 2.5s elsewhere. But at least here, it is still 3. So there is actually some pretty decent discrepancies based on where you're betting this game.
So I don't know. I know I'm sure Ed's not going to like this, Jim. You may not either. But when you look at the, I'm reluctant to say this, the public sentiment around this game, if you talk to your friends and you text your buddies and you go on social media, there's a lot of people who like the Buffalo Bills here. It almost feels like they're a square dog. And I know that sounds silly, and the numbers, you know, shoot that stuff out of the water. But I'll say this. I think the Bills have covered 7 of 8, with not covering against the Colts. And the Chiefs have not covered, I believe, in their last 9 games. And there's the Mahomes stuff. It almost feels like the general public loves the Buffalo Bills here. And we're forgetting that, you know, this is still Patrick Mahomes and Tyreek Hill and Andy Reid. And, I mean, this is going to sound silly also, but do you guys know when the last time the Buffalo Bills trailed in the second half of a football game was? I had to look this up.
Well, definitely Hail Murray.
Oh, yeah.
Hail Murray game. Over 2 months ago. We haven't seen Josh Allen face any real second half adversity at all. I am curious, with no running game to speak of, with Moss out, how is Allen, McDermott, Dable, how are they going to call plays? Because I will say this, Dable has started out, hey, let's throw on everything early. Let's throw. I haven't been overly impressed with them in the last quarter and a half, or a game and a half, I'll say. First half, you know, they showed well, I thought, in the opener against the Colts. But I'm curious how this Buffalo Bills team will do playing from behind, if that is the case in the second half.
Well, that's kind of, I think, the time where you see the, like, we've seen the bad parts of Josh Allen be reduced significantly this year. But there have still been times, thinking back to the Rams game specifically, I think it was week 2 or week 3, he had the bad Josh Allen in there at times still. Like, that game, he went a little psycho a couple of times. There were several incidents there. And if he's put in a bad spot, like you were alluding to, it's possible those come back. I don't know if he's fully eradicated the negative plays from his repertoire. I think that's an interesting angle to bring up here, because if they do get down, what will Buffalo do? Can they respond, or will Josh Allen regress back into some of those old bad habits where he plays really erratically, where things get out of hand in a hurry?
Yeah, so Jim, first of all, Josh Allen was freaking brilliant against the Rams. I spent the whole first half cursing that guy because I had the Rams side. Okay? So yeah,
only the fourth quarter. Sorry, you're right.
He had a couple bad plays in the second half, and you know, and then obviously the pass interference that made me curse very loudly. But I don't know. I think this is a different quarterback in Josh Allen. When you look at my adjusted success rate, he's just been so brilliant, like on a Mahomes, on a Aaron Rodgers type level. And I think he could do it. I think Jason actually brings up a great point about game situation, right? Because it's clearly easier to play quarterback when you're up most of the game. Buffalo have, if not for the Hail Murray, I think they've won 12 in a row. And that's part of that game script. Like, he's not down when you're more likely to throw an interception. So I think that's a great point, Jason. Something I need to think about a little bit more. You know, I mean, my numbers have Chiefs by like 3.3. So pretty close to where this market is. I mean, I'm definitely leaning towards Buffalo because I really do think Josh Allen has been a great quarterback this year, and just question marks with Mahomes and his health situation. And by the way, like, he's going to pass concussion protocol because he didn't have a concussion. Right?
Yeah, that's what, like,
his head never hit anything forcibly, right? I think a lot of these reports says he tweaked a nerve, and that's why he was groggy getting up and made it look like a concussion. So he's going to pass concussion protocol. The question to me is that toe. And we'll see. I don't know if we can know for sure anything about that.
Yeah, absolutely. So Jason, it's still a bit early in the week. As you mentioned, it is Wednesday when we're recording this. Yeah. Any numbers standing out for you with this game, whether it be the spread, the total, any player props you're checking out, anything standing out for you here?
Well, I want to go back. I think Ed just said something about Josh Allen. I do wonder, like, this is a guy who, in his playoff games, he has had these YOLO moments where he drops back and he's like, I'm going to make a play here, hell or high water. And he's kind of loosey-goosey with the ball. And again, you can't quantify that. We don't know if it's going to happen. We don't know what he's like under pressure. I just keep going back to his first playoff game, and it was his first one against Houston, where it was just repeatedly vomiting all over himself.
Well, he had that crazy attempted lateral. Like, that was one of the most obscene plays I've seen in my entire life.
You guys said he's a young quarterback. We don't know how he's going to handle some adversity. I will say this. I had Mike Sando on my podcast, great writer at The Athletic. He had a stat that jumped out that the Buffalo Bills were 6-0 heading into the Ravens game, averaging, I think it was 31 points per game versus EPA top 10 defenses. Well, they're now 7-0. You know, the offensive numbers have come down. I don't have the numbers in front of me. Chiefs are not sniffing the top 10 EPA defense, right?
No. I think they're 20th, if I recall correctly. Josh Allen has averaged 0.45 passing and expected points per dropback against top 10 teams this year. That's not the same number that Mike was citing, but I know that number off the top of my head because it was outlierishly good. He's been disgusting against those top 10 defenses, but like you said, the Chiefs are not that.
Yeah. And do we know anything about Breland's status? I think he left with a concussion.
He was limited on Wednesday. Yeah.
Okay. I mean, you know, Ravens had good cornerbacks, and Diggs still had a really strong game. There's an opportunity for them to break this open. I do think Honey Badger, who was absolutely otherworldly against the Browns. I mean, he felt like he was in the backfield whenever he wanted to. He's a magnet to the football. He's the guy I would worry about if I were Josh Allen. You know, he's just going to be lurking. He's going to have some blitzes coming out of the secondary. I'm hoping, you know, obviously if I'm on the Chiefs, that he has a big game.
Well, Jason, it's going to be a fun weekend of games. I'm looking forward to seeing how things play out. You know, hopefully those favorites can push through for you, and you can have a better weekend this weekend than the past weekend.
Last one real quick. Had you guys looked at any props for Chiefs Bills? I haven't dug into the, you know, because of the Mahomes thing. I've been waiting, but any props jump out to you?
So one I will mention to you to have an eye on is John Brown. He's at 50 and a half receiving yards right now. John Brown is a very good wide receiver, and I feel like he kind of gets overlooked due to Stephon Diggs. Now, the reason this number is probably low is because the Chiefs, pending the Breland health, do have really good cornerback play. They have been tremendous against outside wide receivers this year. That may lead to some pessimism around John Brown. He did have a donut in the first playoff game this year, which was terror for my DFS lineups. But I think he's hit 70 receiving yards in like 6 out of 10 or so healthy games this year, and it's a 50 and a half. So I would say if you're looking for a player to check out, I would say John Brown would be at the front of my mind personally, specifically at FanDuel Sports, but he's at 50 and a half for the receiving yards there.
Okay.
But I think it's interesting. So you'll have to dig into those and see what fits your fancy by the end of the week. That is Jason McIntyre. Make sure you check him out on the Straight Fire podcast. He is also on Talk the Line. You can find him on FS1 and Fox Sports Radio. Jason, it was a pleasure having you back here in the FanDuel sphere. I appreciate the time, and good luck to you this weekend.
Thanks a lot, guys. Good luck to you as well.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Covering the future.
Big thank you once again to Jason McIntyre for swinging by and breaking down the conference championships. And Ed, I always find the discussions around Josh Allen fun because, like, it's okay to admit that we were wrong. I'm wrong a lot, so I get plenty of chances to do this. But, like, I feel like I'd rather admit that I'm wrong about Josh Allen than sit here and stew and get angry every time that he makes a good play. Because, like you said, he's just a fun player to watch, and I think that I would much rather admit that I'm wrong than just dig in. I will never admit that I'm wrong about Jared Goff. That will never happen. But with Josh Allen's kind of the opposite. I will admit that I was wrong there because it just allows me to have more fun watching the game. I'm okay being wrong if it allows me to have more fun.
Right, for sure. I mean, I think being wrong is a big part of this business. If you're wrong 45% of the time, it's pretty good. And I think, like, for me, you have to be willing to swallow your pride. I mean, I beginning of the year, I did not think much of Josh Allen, but, you know, through a combination of the numbers and through watching games, like, I think it was like Tennessee the Monday night game that they played?
Tennessee was a Monday night game where people started to rag on him again, but his actual play within that game was not as bad as it would look if you looked at the numbers.
And that's the game where I was like, yeah, they're losing, but he's on target with every one of these passes. It's like, so what? And then, you know, you see the numbers later, and they're top five, and they're still top five. And, you know, when I look at adjusted success rate, they were one for a while. They were first for a while, but they've fallen behind. Not a great game against a pretty good Ravens defense. But, yeah, I think in life you have to be able to take in new data and change your mind about things. Like, that's just
part of being a reasonable human being.
Unless they're Jared Goff, in which case I will never be reasonable. I refuse. You will never get me to go down with the sinking ship. Let's dive into covering the future. And Ed, your covering the future is one you can actually bet at FanDuel Sportsbook later this week, because
yeah,
online wagering is becoming legal in Michigan on Friday. Congratulations.
So online sports betting is going to be legal in Michigan on Friday, which is pretty cool. And yeah, but I might not bet this game because I'm sure John Sheeran might be the first, you know, they're having their meeting right now about what side they want to take. And it's, you know, Green Bay's a 3-point favorite, but I wouldn't be surprised if they stake their stake in the ground and put this at 2.5 before everyone else gets there. I mean, I like Tampa Bay in this game. I feel like I could say almost. So this was what I was thinking. I have this whole thing prepared, and I'll talk about some of it. But think about it this way. Like, I feel like a lot of the same things I felt last week. You know, New Orleans is a good team. Yeah, they're good. And I believe more in Green Bay's offense than I do in New Orleans' offense. But New Orleans has much better defense than Green Bay, right? And at the end of the day, I still believe in the upside of Tampa Bay's offense. I still think they're a lot better than the numbers are. And spoiler alert, I like Tampa Bay +3. A couple of things that, you know, we should look at. Like, you know, the Packers were very good last week against a very good Los Angeles Rams defense. 61% success rate compared to an NFL average of 45%. You know, you could make the argument that, oh, Aaron Donald wasn't effective because he had that rib injury. But, you know, everyone else on that unit was there, right? Like, I think they get credit for what they did against that unit. And when you look at their schedule, it's not littered with great defenses at all, because the last great defense they probably played, I mean, the Bears were good the week before, but they kind of weren't the same towards the end of the season, especially defending the pass. So the last good defense they probably faced was Tampa Bay. So that was week 6. And in that game, they had a 36% success rate, which was by far Green Bay's worst total of the year. Okay. So I never put too much stock in one game. I think they'll do a lot better this time. But like, Tampa Bay does bring in a really good unit to this game. On the other side of the ball, yeah, you know, like, I believe in Tampa Bay's offense. They're 7th when I look at adjusted success rate in terms of passing. I think they're better than that. Brady's passing grades have been great on PFF. They have elite receivers. Same stuff I've said all year for the last couple weeks. So when I look at my numbers, like, every metric that I have that go into my ensemble has this as a really tight game within 1 point. Overall, the model says Green Bay by, I mean, basically a push, right? Like, Green Bay by 0.3. And I think Tampa Bay's even better than what my numbers say. So, like, I'm definitely going, taking the points here with Tampa Bay.
And this is not a new thing for you to be talking about specifically the upside of Tampa Bay's offense. We had our standalone podcast with just you and me back in week 15, and we were talking about the futures market. And I asked you which team entices you in the futures market. And you said Tampa Bay, because you were looking for offenses that had untapped upside. And specifically the offensive side, you said, I think they have untapped upside. And we've had 5 games since then. I would say their past 2 games have been their best 2 offensive performances, considering opponent, probably the entire year for Tampa Bay's offense. Like, yeah, they've been really good the past 2 weeks against 2 good pass rushes, which have given them fits in the past. So you've been saying this for a while. It's not like you're buying on the bandwagon late here or anything. And I think that that's valuable to have. So I think that this makes a lot of sense. I'm also very jealous of you having Michigan with the legal online sports betting, because my governor has decided that they want to do it through the lottery, which is what Washington, D.C. has done. Oh, and that's been a dumpster fire. Yeah. So there will be no competition. I might need to bunk with you in Ann Arbor. Because, like, we have it now at casinos, and I think that's what you have in Michigan right now, is you can go to the casino in person, but that's not great during a pandemic, which makes the legal options pretty unenticing. So I am very jealous, Ed. I'm very jealous of Michigan as a whole, and I wish that common sense prevail in my great state of New York as well.
Yeah, well, hopefully it will. I mean, it has been a long wait here as well, because basically the casinos allowed sports betting as soon as the pandemic hit, right? So they were going to do it right before March Madness, and now we get it today. So so that's a good thing. One more thing about Tampa Bay at Green Bay. I talked to Peter Bukowski of Lockdown Packers weeks ago, and we talked about teams that he didn't want to play
One of them was Tampa Bay, for sure. One of my good friends is a big-time Green Bay fan, rabidly rooting for New Orleans last week. So I think that tells you a lot about this game as well.
Absolutely. So we'll see how that one goes. And I actually have a similar line of thought with you here, because my covering the future is the over in that game, 51.5. And a lot of the same thought processes apply, where we think the Tampa Bay offense is really good. I agree with you there wholeheartedly. I also think the Green Bay offense will be able to move the ball here. So I think the over is in play here. I actually think both overs are interesting. The Bills defense, I think that there is some legitimacy to them playing well. I know that what Jason said is fully valid about them, you know, in the Indy game not being the best. But it gets me skittish enough where when you toss that in with the potential for some rain and Patrick Mahomes' toe, I am okay feeling better about this total than the other one. So I'm going to go the over here at 51.5 for the Packers versus the Bucks. The concern here with games in Green Bay will always be weather, but it looks fine right now. Right now, 29 degrees, just 11-mile-per-hour winds, no precipitation, none of that bothers me, and that's good enough for me to have the green light here. And both these defenses are solid, but neither is elite. That's especially true against the pass. The Bucs, 7th against the pass for the full season based on numberFire's metrics. Packers are 13th. That's good, but it's not great. And last week, the Packers, as you mentioned, were facing the league's second-best pass defense. They put up 32 points in that game. The Bucs are facing the league's third-ranked pass defense. They scored 30 in that game. Both these offenses did well against better pass defenses last week than what they'll face this week. The Packers aren't a super fast team. They finished 31st this year in situation-neutral pace, according to Football Outsiders. But this will be an up-tempo game for them because the Bucs finished 4th in schedule-adjusted pace. Antonio Brown is kind of the one injury question mark in this one. He did miss practice on Wednesday, but he's not a huge part of that offense. He has 16% of the team's targets in the games with Mike Evans healthy. Just 11% of the deep targets there. It's Mike Evans who's the moneymaker in this offense, and he's fully healthy. So this sets up as a game where I'd expect at least the Packers be very pass-heavy. They threw 67% of the time in early downs in the first half in that first meeting. The Buccaneers did run more, but now Ronald Jones not fully healthy. So I'd expect there to be some passes in this game. I'd expect those passes to be efficient against these defenses, which means I expect there to be points. So I'm going to take the over here, 51.5, and go with this Green Bay versus Tampa Bay game. So we're both kind of on the same page here, where we think the Tampa Bay offense is legit, which leads us to different paths, but kind of the same reasoning to those paths for this game.
For sure. And look, Green Bay's offense is legit too, right? Yeah. So they've been fantastic. So I drew Dinzik on the Football Analytics Show, and he talked about the success that LaFleur is having in those scripted plays at the beginning of the game. And you've seen Green Bay get off to these leads. But I agree with you. I see you can see what Tampa Bay can do. Completely expect this to be a close game. Maybe you get some extra points heading into overtime because, you know, can't end this one in a tie.
Can you parlay both games going to overtime? Just because I want that to happen. It's not like a good process bet. It's probably a terrible – I think like it's 3-1 for any game to go to the overtime in the rest of the playoffs. But, like, I think this could happen. It could be a lot of fun. Yeah. We're going to see a good weekend of football, and I can't complain about that. The past two weekends have been less than satisfactory at times, so hopefully we crank things up here with the final multi-game slate of the weekend. That is all the time that we have for today, but Ed, still plenty of stuff going on outside of covering the spread. So what's going on for you over at the Power Rank right now?
Yeah, I had Drew Dinzik, frequent guest on this show, Whale Capper. By the way, it's whale_capper on Twitter. You can't miss the underscores. I figured out. So I had him on the Football Analytics Show. You know what Drew's all about. He talked about the games, but we talked a little bit more about his methods and the math and some of the techie stuff. And then, of course, we talked about Mexican food because that's what he and I talk about when we get together. So it was a really good episode. Definitely check that out. And then my newsletter is always available. Actually, this week is kind of nice because you get my spread prediction in both games. You can sign up for that free service. It's at thepowerrank.com. And then I've been posting videos on my Twitter account, just some short little insights. There are less than 140 seconds because that's what Twitter allows for. So I got one coming up on the Kansas City Chiefs and their secret edge on offense. And pretty excited about it. It's a data visualization this week. And I'm excited that I think video is like the best medium for data visualization, because you can look at the data visualization and then comprehend what's going on with your ears. So I'm interested in exploring that both this week with the Chiefs and then more so in the offseason.
With the data viz thing, it's fully valid because I can't concentrate on one thing for more than 5 seconds. But if I have two different sources shoveling the same information at me at the same time, I will digest it better. So as someone who has terrible attention deficit, like I can't pay attention to anything, that's very helpful for me. So I appreciate it personally, and I will speak for everyone in saying thank you for that. Also, I'm glad that you have Drew on your podcast, because that's my one regret with having him here, is that he covers so many sports. We always want to talk about, okay, we want basketball, we want football, we want some tennis. We don't have time to talk with him about like the nuts and bolts of what he does, but what he does is so smart that I wish we had more time to like sit back and talk about the in-depth process he has. That's why I'm glad that you have him on your show, the Football Analytics Show, because like that's so valuable, and it's so fun to hear him talk about what goes into his models.
Yeah, absolutely. And I've talked to him a lot about his models and the process, but I actually never talked to him about what is the raw data that goes in there.
Yeah.
And so that was interesting too. I'll leave it for you guys to go check that out. But it's changed over the years, as you think it would, and it will probably continue to change as well.
All right, you can find that conversation with Drew Dinzik over on the Football Analytics Show, and check out the powerrank.com for all of Ed's stuff. Also, check out Ed on Twitter for those Twitter videos, at the Power Rank. I am at Jim Sonnes, J-I-M-S-A-N-N-E-S. You can also follow the FanDuel Podcast Network at FanDuel Podcast, our daily fantasy podcast for the conference championships. The final two-game slate of the year will be up tomorrow. We're recording that live on YouTube at 10 a.m. Eastern, Thursday, I should say, 10 a.m. Eastern, and also on the numberFire Daily Fantasy Podcast feed immediately after that. Big thank you to Calvin Theobald, our video producer, for running the video side of things here today. Thank you, Cal, as always. Thank you to Jason McIntyre, our guest for today. Check him out on Twitter at Jason R. McIntyre, and check out the Straight Fire Podcast. Check him out on Talk the Line and on FS1 and Fox Sports Radio. Thank you to everyone for tuning in. Good luck to you with your bets for the conference championships. We'll talk to you once again for our first podcast previewing Super Bowl LV. I think that's 55. I don't know. I'll brush up my Roman numerals before next week. We'll talk to you then. This has been Covering the Spread right here on the FanDuel Podcast Network.